Okay. So today we want to prove the following theorem. So this is published, and it says that if X is a smooth projective variety, over a finite field, which fulfills two assumptions. The first one, X is absolutely irreducible. And the second one is a char group of zero cycles, which I'm going to explain in a moment, of X over a large field, and large field is the function field of X, and from this, its algebraic closure. So if this one, tensor Q, is Q, then X has a rational form. And more precisely, the number of rational points is non-trivial, and it is 1 modulo Q, as we got used to. OK? So let us first discuss the notion of Chow groups briefly, and then give applications of the theorem, and then prove it. And actually, we have half of the preparation already. So first, on Chow groups. So if X is any variety, it doesn't have to be, let me write smooth, because then we have to modify the definition. So smooth variety defined over a field K. Then K later on will be, because we consider the Chow group of zero cycles over this large field, so then K will be this large field here. Then one defines and one fixes dimension M, and one defines the Chow group of M cycles on X, and X means here over K as follows. This is a free abelian group. Oops. So the free abelian group generated by all M-dimensional irreducible and reduced subvarieties . So this is just a group here, it's a free group spanned by all these subvarieties, which are defined over K. Then modulo the so-called rational equivalence relation. And rational equivalence relation means that, it means that it is span, that the smallest relation in this free group here, which is span by divisors of rational functions f, which live on subvarieties of dimension one more. So let me write divisor of f lower w, where w lies in x, is a subvariety of dimension one more, so of dimension m plus one, and f is a rational function on W. So if you are, let us draw a little picture here. For example, assume, do you have a question, Mihai? No? So let us assume x was two-dimensional, and then we would look at the Chow group of zero cycles. then the rational equivalence relation would tell us that we have close points here, which are not necessarily K rational points, but they are close points, they are defined over the given field. And then to say that those are equivalent, so let's say those two are equivalent, would mean that we find curves in such a way that on this one I have a rational function, let's say it's one, on this two, on the second one I have a rational function f2, on this one I have a rational function f3, in such a way that when I look at the divisor of f1, which is obviously a zero cycle on this curve and a fortiori a zero cycle on the surface, and then I add to it the divisor of f2 and then the divisor of f3, then as a zero cycle on the surface, this is just this one minus this one. Okay? So this is the definition. So for example, if M is the dimension of x minus 1, then this notion is just peak. Because x is smooth. And any line bundle corresponds to divisor. And the equivalence relation is just the one we wrote. Okay. So in particular on our drawing, so now that we know what is a Chow group, if we specialize the discussion here for zero, for m equals 0, then we see that one way to make the Chow group of zero circles trivial here is to assume, so in particular, so examples, oh no, okay, in particular, if f is such that on any capital K, on any field which is algebraically closed and which contains a field of definition, so let's say x defined over little k contains a field of definition, if on any algebraically closed field which contains a field of definition, then x over capital K is rationally connected, then the Chow group of zero cycle on X cross capital K is trivial. So let's say a tensor Q means this is obviously an abelian group here, and lower Q here means that I just replace Z by Q here. I tensor everything by Q. So this we see on our diagram, because to say that this variety of a capital K is rationally connected means that any two close points, for example those two, may be linked now by a chain of rational curves, and this chain has to be connected. And then by the elementary property of P1, then we have a rational function, the divisor of which is this one minus this one, then we have a rational function on this rational curve here, the divisor of which is this one minus this one, and so forth, and consequently this point is equivalent to this point. So, in particular, a corollary of the theorem here is that if X is rationally connected over a finite field and absolutely irreducible, then X has a rational point. And in particular, this applies to fan overwrites by the fundamental theorem, so in particular for Fanos, by the fundamental theorem of Campana, and independently Kolar, Miyaoka Mori, which is telling us that any Fano variety over an algebraically closed field has a property that any two closed points are linked by a connected chain of rational curves. So according to what we had yesterday on our proof, Remember from yesterday? That we had seen 2 points. The following is that X being smooth projective and absolutely irreducible implies that the number of over the finite field FQ implies that X has a rational point is equivalent to saying, and actually when I say equivalent would mean that this statement is true for every finite extension of Q, of FQ, so let me write here QS for all S. Then this is equivalent to saying that the eigenvalues of the geometric Frobenius acting on the ethal L-adic homology of X for M at least one are all Q divisible as algebraic integers. So they lie in Q times Z bar. And remember also from yesterday that if, so let me introduce the notation, if the cohomology, the ethal cohomology of X for M, for all M at least one, fulfills the coniveau property, so let me write and then I explain. Fulfills this equation equals N1 HMX bar, then the eigenvalues of Frobenius, I didn't use this notation yesterday, then the eigenvalues of Frobenius acting on the cohomology here are Q divisible as algebraic integers. And now on the notation on 2, so on notation of 2, then this is a notation which has been introduced by Grothendieck as well as a terminology. So this is called here the first level of the coniveau filtration. And it is defined as follows. This is a subgroup or a subvector space of the cohomology group. So it consists of all those classes, cohomology classes here, which die outside of a divisor, such that there is a U in X, a U on non-empty Zariski open, such that alpha restricted to U dies via restriction in the cohomology of U. And because this vector space here, this group, is finite dimensional as a vector space, then this is equivalent to saying there is an A in X, which is a divisor, which has a property that via localization here, then the image is just this N1. And because I have finitely many classes to test. Okay. And then yesterday we saw that if this group surchecks onto the cohomology of X, that means if the cohomology of X lives in codimension 1, then the Frobenius eigenvalues here are Q-divisible. So now we are in the position to do the proof. And the proof relies on an ID which is due to Spencer Bloch, which is called the Bloch's decomposition on the diagonal. Which he didn't use it in this context, but he decomposed the diagonal as follows. So let us do it. So the statement is that the assumption on the Chow group, so the Chow group here, or let's say X defined over a field K and X smooth. And then, so let us replace this FQ by K. So this is general. It has nothing to do with finite fields, and actually it was never used before for finite fields. Then this group being Q, so tensor Q being Q, is equivalent to saying that there is a zero cycle, so zero cycle, on X, which is defined over K, together with a divisor A, so divisor, which is also defined over K inside of X, together with a cycle gamma, which lies in X cross A, which is also defined over K, and which has dimension D, so the X is smooth of dimension D over K, such that, and there is an integer. There is an integer which is at least 1, such that the diagonal decomposes as follows. There is a divisor inside of X, a cycle of dimension D inside of X cross A, and an integer which is at least 1, such that the diagonal modulo this N multiplicator here, which is understood, the diagonal here is a physical, I mean it's a subvariety of X cross X. So in particular, it is a class here. This will be a class in the Chow group of D cycles in X cross X, and I just, like this, is equal in this group to Xi cross X plus gamma. So let us show that proof of the decomposition. Let's say quick proof of the decomposition. The first point is that in general, if one considers the Chow group of M cycles on X, and one goes to the Chow group of M cycles on a larger field, so let's say this is defined over K and we take any larger field capital K, then the kernel. So there's an obvious map here, because if we have an M cycle defined over K, it is a fortiori an M cycle defined over a larger field. And if we have a rational equivalence which is defined over a small field, a fortiori it is defined over the large field. So there's a natural best change map here. And the kernel here is torsion. And why is that torsion? It's easy to understand, because I mean all those notions, algebraic cycles and rational equivalence relation, are algebraic notions, are defined by cycles, they have finitely many coefficients. And this is telling you that the kernel is torsion. So this is torsion, and so we apply this. And this is a fundamental idea which is behind Bloch's decomposition of the diagonal. He applies this to spec K of X. And then let us take capital K, which is the algebraic closure of K of X. And then we obtain that the kernel of the Chow group of zero cycle on X pulled back to its function field into the Chow group of zero cycle on X cross capital K. This is torsion. But now our assumption, so here we have a privileged cycle here, because we have a KX rational point, which is spec of the function field, so that's the general point of the variety over its function field. So this defines a class in the Chow group. the field of definition of which is very large. And the assumption is telling us that this zero cycle here is equivalent here in this group to a zero cycle, the field of definition of which is very low, because this group is supposed to be Q. So consequently, there is, and because the kernel of this map is torsion here, then this means that there is a psi, which is a zero cycle defined over K, such that our general point here, understood as a class in the Chow group of zero cycles over this large field, possibly with some torsion here, is equivalent to psi in Chow group of X pulled back to its function field. But now, so the next point, and we are done. We are through with the arguments. And the next point is saying that indeed, the Chow group of zero cycle of X pulled back over its general point here is the inductive limit over all U's, which are Zariski open and non-empty, inside of X, of the Chow group of D cycles in X cross X. And why is this? Well, this is because everything is algebraic, so when we have a zero cycle defined over this field, then there will be an open in X on which it is really a cycle in X cross U. And then it will be a d-dimensional cycle. So in particular, our class here, which was just the generic point, is a restriction of the diagonal here on X cross X. So this is the restriction. So let me write here, excuse me. So our class here. So as a class, I just write a big parenthesis like this. This is a restriction of the diagonal to X cross KX. So therefore, as a consequence, our class here, which has the decomposition which is written here, and n times, so this decomposition here is equivalent to saying, so the decomposition 2 now is equivalent to saying that the diagonal restricted to some open, so here some open, and then modulo torsion is equal to psi cross U. So in the Chow group of D cycles in X cross U, and consequently, the diagonal here on X cross X has a shape which is written here, so consequently star. So now, once we have a decomposition of the diagonal as a decomposition in the Chow group, then classes in the Chow group here act on cohomology via correspondence. This was a decomposition of the diagonal. So now, whenever we have a cycle, so for, let's say, Z, a cycle in X cross X, Chow D of X cross X, then Z acts as a correspondence on cohomology, then Z acts as a correspondence on cohomology. And it acts as follows. So from H, let's say M, to HM, as follows. One considers any class alpha in HMX bar, then one consider its inverse image. So this is going to be a class in HM of X bar cross X bar, where P1 is the first projection. And then once we're on the product, I mean, it's just like the correspondence. So for example, we had several talks on the Fourier-Moucaille correspondence. This is exactly the same thing. Then we can cup this with a class of our, the cohomology class of our cycle here. So one has to know that the Chow group is an invariant of the variety which is stronger than the cohomology. So it maps to cohomology and yields cohomology classes. So we have cycle classes like this. So we have this this product here. So this is living in H M plus the cohomology class here 2D of X cross X comma D. And now we can apply to this when X is proper, so X is projective, then we have P2 upper star from cohomology HM plus 2D X cross X comma D to HM of X, so I forgot the bars here, and that's the correspondence. And now this correspondences here, I said it depends only on the class of the cycle in the Chow group, so in particular, via this decomposition of the diagonal. The diagonal, so if we take Z to be the diagonal, then this correspondence is the identity. And because our etal cohomology here is with QL coefficients, the QL vector space and QL is a field of characteristic zero, so the end here is not important. So that is a very important thing. If we were doing this for Durham cohomology for varieties defined over finite fields, then we would be dead. That's the reason why one cannot prove certain vanishings one would like to prove for finite varieties. So n doesn't play any role. L is irrelevant as our cohomology here is a QL vector space, and this has characteristic zero. So now we decompose our identity, our n times identity, so n times identity on cohomology is going to be this correspondence here, so I write like this with brackets here, plus this correspondence. But now a little thought here shows that the correspondence here on HM X bar factors through the restriction map HM X bar to HM Xi bar. So in particular, because it's a zero cycle, which is defined over K, then this is zero. So then so this group is zero for M at least one. So when I write, actually the way it comes out here, this one is effective anyway. If it was not effective, I would have to take the components and say the same thing. So it factors through this group, and this is skilled because it's a zero cycle, so it's a bunch of points. And when we look at the cohomology of a bunch of points of an algebraically closed field, then this cohomology is trivial for M at least one. So consequently, then N times the identity on HM X bar for M at least one is just the correspondence gamma. But now an easy thought, which is even easier than this one, tells us that the moment gamma lies physically in X cross A, then the image of the correspondence gamma lies in the image of the cohomology with supporting gamma inside of HMX bar. But because this is n times the identity, this is telling us that this whole group is supported along the divisor A. So because this is the image of gamma, because gamma is the identity modulo n, this is just the whole group. And it lies inside the image of the cohomology supported in the divisor. So that finishes the proof. So now let us discuss the theorem a little bit before going on. Oops. So that means, you see, so first at the philosophical level, so discussion. You remember that in the introduction on the first day, we had on the board this Deligne's philosophy. Which was telling us that it is linking the Hodge type of variety defined over the field of complex numbers to Q divisibility of the eigenvalues of Frobenius acting on ethyl cohomology. Okay? So here, for the examples we are looking at, so the first application we have is for Fano varieties. Then we think we have Fano varieties defined over the field of complex numbers. We have Fano varieties defined over finite fields. Excuse me, I forgot finite fields here, for varieties defined over finite fields. But there is no direct way physically, purely geometrically, to go from the variety defined over C to variety defined, well, actually more vice versa. Even also in this case here, because we are assuming the variety is smooth, so who tells us that this one will specialize to smooth variety, and vice versa, you have Fano varieties which are smooth in characteristic P, which do not lift to characteristic zero, so there is no direct way. But here, the way is purely cohomological, so it's not given really by a physical degeneration of anything, but the way is cohomological using this motivic cohomology, using this, those chalk groups. Cohomological correspondence. Thank you. using chalk groups, using. Okay, so that's the first comment, while in the second example, which we won't have the power to prove today, because this would force me to introduce much more material, which we don't have at disposal, but we can at least discuss some features. While in the second example, you remember this unequal characteristic example, which I will write cleanly in the second half of the lecture, while in second example, the relation is direct. It's a physical relation between characteristic zero and characteristic P. So we have really a degeneration from characteristic zero to characteristic P. Okay, that's the first comment. Now, second comment is that the theorem applies to Fano, and I underline the word Fano in the conference because many of the geometers attending the conference are working on Fano varieties, but those are not the only varieties for which we can apply the theorem. So for example, we have those beautiful examples of Shioda. Which are surfaces in P3 of a very high degree, as high as we want. We just want that the degree, so surface means smooth. So this is over FQ, of degree N, which is as large as we want. All we want is that it satisfies a congruence relation with respect to Q, which I forget. I'm sorry. I didn't have time to look. I think it's something like degree D Oh no, maybe I should put n because d so far was always a dimension. Degree n was congruent to 1 modulo q, but here I don't guarantee. Maybe it's congruent to 3 modulo q or something. So here I, or maybe it's minus 1, so I don't guarantee here. But the feature of the congruence is that this congruence is fulfilled for an infinite sequence of degrees. And in particular, those surfaces, consequently, are of general type. So for n large, and we can compute what large means here, I don't do it, then the surfaces here are of general type. And then the statement of Schroeder's is that for each of those degrees here which fulfills this congruence, then there is such a surface here which is unirational. So there is always, so for each n, there is such a surface, let's say x lower n, which is unirational. So consequently, according to our theorem, Schroeder surfaces have a rational point. And those are surfaces of general type. I'm sorry? No, sir. Yeah, excuse me. Thank you very much. Thank you. Is that okay? Next point is in discussion. I mean, in a way, it was maybe less expected, you see, because surface of general type is not easy to find rational points. Next point in the discussion, we have so far discussed only on smooth varieties, and indeed we used the smoothness heavily in the computation. The computation of the Chow group is fine, it refers to nothing, but where we use smoothness is to say that our decomposition of the diagonal in the Chow group acts on cohomology. If X was not smooth, it would not act on cohomology unless we have a stronger notion of motivic cohomology. So this one would rather, I mean, in the terminology of Fulton, this would be the so-called homological Chow group. It would act on homology, but it will never act, oh, not never, it will not necessarily act on cohomology. And yet, by the pattern we discussed together, the existence of rational points is linked to Q divisibility on cohomology, not on homology, which homology for ital cohomology with Boyle-Moore homology, that means homology with support along the variety once you have a smooth embedding. Okay? So let us give a definition here which differs from Alessio's definition yesterday. It's more constrained. So let us define X projective over a field K to be a Fano variety. So far we had Fano, so that means Fano manifold, so now Fano variety. So we allow singularity if, so let us make a simplification, if A, X is geometrically irreducible, and B, you see, geometrically irreducible, we saw in ital cohomology where it appears, but you just have to think of dimension zero. You take a field. I mean, this is maybe, you take a finite extension of FQ. So this is a Fano variety. It doesn't have an FQ rational point. So one certainly has to do something, right? So one has to assume geometrically irreducible. And then the second thing is, we assume that it is Gorenstein. So I think most of you know what this means, and if not, it's a technical word which just means that the dualizing sheaf here is invertible. And once it is invertible, then we know what it means to be ample or anti-ample. So the third condition is that it is anti-ample. So omega X inverse is anti-ample. So now, if thank you, Takeshi. Thank you. So if K RAS characteristic 0, then the Kalamata Vivek vanishing theorem is telling us the following thing. So if we take x tilde pi x to be any desingularization, and we take omega x tilde over x, then we know that pi lower star of this shift here lies inside of x, and this is an ideal. So let us define this ideal. And in our days, this is called the multiplier ideal for this shift, but really, it's nothing but the Kawamata-Fivek vanishing theorem, nothing more. And then the Kawamata-Fivek vanishing theorem is telling us that this ideal has vanishing. And then this is for all m at least 1. And then we have two options. Either this ideal is O, that means in technical terms it means that X has a canonical singularities. So then this vanishing can be only true for m at least 1, or else I is really a genuine ideal, the support is really smaller, and then this is for the vanishing is for all m, because there are no sections. So this ideal here defines a subset, a closed subvariety, a closed subscheme. And you see, according, so this is defined by the ideal I. And according to the Hochstab discussion we had on the second day, then this condition here, so the condition star here, implies that the Hodge type of the cohomology of U with, so let me write, the Hodge type of the compactly supported cohomology of X minus this S is at least 1. So consequently, we expect, so I mean, if I extend the Linz philosophy here, then one expects, so you see this S is of course lies inside of the singularities of X by definition. And and it's canonically attached to X. It has nothing to do with the choice of this, the desingularization. So one expects that if X now is defined over a field of characteristic P, but let us cut down the discussion to our situation. So projective. Fano variety with our definition. Then there is a well-defined subscheme S inside of X, actually inside of the singularities of X, which fulfills that the number of rational points of S is congruent to the number of rational points of X modulo Q. So this is a direct consequence of the philosophy we have been expanding during the lectures. So I think it's an interesting question. And it's not an easy question because it consists of two parts. The first one is a purely, coherent questions. How to think of this so-called multiplier ideal in characteristic P without using any other primes. And second question, once we have a singular variety, how to think of the motivic condition which will force the existence of a rational point. On the second point, we have some progress. This is an article with Spencer Block and Mark Levin. And I think it's the exact condition. But this exact condition is very—it's not handy at all because it uses a smooth embedding of the variety. And rather than talking on the variety itself, it talks on the compactly supported cohomology of the complement. And this is certainly not something we would like to have because this requests the knowledge of some embedding. So this is exact mathematically, but it's not the shining piece we would like to have. So I don't discuss this at all. But let me discuss the last point here before making a break. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's the last point of the discussion here. So we have here a hierarchy of conjectures in characteristic zero, which looks as follows. So if the cohomological condition here, which I explained before, so we are in characteristic zero here, is satisfied, then the way we proved here that this implies Q divisibility of the eigenvalues of Frobenius in characteristic zero, it implies that Hodge type is at least one by a much simpler argument. And this simpler argument was indeed the reason why Spencer Block developed his decomposition of the diagonal, because he wanted to explain Mumford's remarkable theorem on PG non equal zero, implying that the Chow group of zero cycles on the surface is huge. He wanted to understand this cohomologically. So this implies, by a much easier argument here, this implies that the Hodge type of X is at least one. Okay? And the Bloch-Bellinson conjectures, so this implies, so let us write like this. So this is, let's say, the decomposition of the diagonal, which we just had here. An easier application. But the Bloch-Bellinson conjecture cut down to this situation here are telling us that this should be equivalent. So Bloch-Bellinson. And really, this piece is rather due to Spencer Block. So let me write here B, Cyrillic B. Is that okay? On the other hand, the proof, as we have seen in a slightly more complicated situation, goes into two steps. The first step is to show that this condition here implies the N1 condition on cohomology, and now the cohomology is just a Durham cohomology. And then this one will imply this one. But you see, that the Hodge type being one, so this one implies this one is computable, it's not hard. Now, the reverse arrow is a Hodge conjecture, the generalized Hodge conjecture. Or an instance of the generalized Hodge conjecture. So the Bloch-Bellinson conjecture contains, as a particular example, the generalized Hodge conjecture, cut down in this situation. And we expect, according to the conjectures, we expect that any geometric property which forces the Hodge type to be at least one, then forces the Chow group to be zero. And if those properties are sufficiently geometric, then according to the lecture, we will expect that over finite fields, the variety will have a rational point. But of course, we don't know that. So one typical example where we know the Hodge type is one is when one can apply the Kodaira vanishing theorem in a slightly better way, like Neff and Big, so the Kawamata-Fivek vanishing theorem. So for omega inverse on X smooth, then we know this implies vanishing, so we know this, but we do not know this. And notice that we have seen that already in the Shioda example. I mean, it's an illustration. You see, the moment a variety is rationally connected, its Chow group of zero cycle is trivial. This just, but the way for Chow group to be trivial, Chow group of zero cycle to be trivial, is in the rule much more complicated than this. Because this group is a group. That means we are not looking at effective cycles, while on a rationally connected variety, the way two zero cycles are identified is via an effective way. So that means this is, so to speak, a way to be trivial in the Chow group by using the monoid structure and not the whole group structure. So this is obviously something which is very rare. While Chow group of zero cycles being trivial here, one expects much more flexibility. And as we see with these Schoda examples here, I mean, this one certainly won't, yeah, okay. So so I make a break of 3 minutes and we resume. Talk, Andrew, is that okay? Okay, so the first generalization of our theorem is like this. So this is due to Fak-Rudin and Rajan. And it is telling us that if X, F from X to S is a projective morphism, with so defined over FQ with X, S absolutely irreducible, then if the Chow group of zero cycles of X over S pull back to the algebraic closure of the function field of X is trivial, then each closed fiber here will have a rational point. So for all closed points, of S, then the number of rational points of the corresponding fiber, so this is F inverse of S, and this is rational points with values, of course, in the residue field of S, kappa of S. Then this is congruent to 1 modulo the cardinality of the residue field, kappa of S. No, I mean what I wrote.
Oh, so what
yes.
Is the from S to, what is the mod from this
KS bar to AS? No, this is, you can restrict here to KS, and this is certainly a subfield.
Okay.
So I meant what I wrote. The point is that inside of here you have the diagonal in the fiber product. I mean, when you extend. Okay? So you see, so for example, when S is a point, this would be, then this is our theorem. And the method is, of course, the same. And I don't elaborate because that's the same. This is a nice formulation. But it doesn't say anything. You see, you remember that our proof was going first to Conivo, and then we were searching for a condition which implies a Conivo, and this was this Chow condition. And here, this proof here doesn't, unfortunately, doesn't say what is the right thing. I mean, it's a motivic condition, and it doesn't single out the right cohomological condition, Conivo condition. Yet, it's a nice formulation. And this, combined with the theorem which I had written on the second day, plus the theorem, which was, I just repeat briefly, that if X is, so we are on characteristic zero, and those two are smooth. And then if the Hodge type of a smooth fiber is at least 1, then so is the Hodge type of a singular fiber. And you remember we had a very precise phrasing, which I don't repeat. Then this convinces one that the following theorem might be true, and indeed it is. So let me write down correctly the theorem. So let K be a p-adic field. So you see, you remember one way to think of a p-adic field is just to say that it's a, so this finite residue field, So we denote this finite residue field by FQ. The one way to think of this is that K is a finite extension of QP. So let X be proper smooth, projective, let's say. Smooth. Absolutely irreducible. Over K, so in characteristic zero. And let us assume, so what is the assumption? Or maybe I should say, as I did during the whole lecture, so erase this and write assumption absolutely irreducible. And then secondly, the coniveau condition is fulfilled, so H1 HM X bar is HM X bar for all M at least one. Then the conclusion is that the special fiber of a regular model, so if X over R, so R being inside of K, the ring of integers. And if X over R is a regular model, so last time there were questions when I used the word, so let me say what it means. So let's say pi here. So actually I should put spec here, excuse me. So pi regular model means pi projective. Then means the generic fiber of X is our given X. So the generic fiber of curly X is our given straight X. And so far we have talked on model and now we use the word regular. And regular means that X as a scheme, not as a scheme defined over a field or over a ring, but as a scheme, is regular. So X is regular. That means in each point, in each cross point, there is a regular sequence of parameters. Then if X is a regular model, then its reduction mod P, so its cross fiber, so X mod P, which classically is denoted by Y over spec of FQ, fulfills that the number of rational points of Y is 1 modulo Q. So you see, this Y might be a cone, comments. Y might be very singular. And on the other hand, this is, so Y might be very singular. So in particular, this gives a very, let me write in quotation marks like this, motivic explanation for Axe and Katz theorem. But only for level kappa equals 1. Okay. So let me comment. So this N1 now we understood. So for example, as a corollary, we have KR little k being FQ as before. And then X projective smooth with 1 as before, and now 2 is replaced by 2 prime, which is a priori a stronger condition, but according to the corollary of the Bloch-Bahnsen conjecture, which we wrote on the board, should be equivalent to this motivic condition, but we are We are very far from understanding this. So if x then such a y has a, fulfills the same thing. So then same conclusion. So second corollary. Ah, before I write it, let me make a comment. So I have written that we expect, you see, to go from this Chow condition to the N1 condition, even if we, if it is conjectured to be the same assumption, then we really don't understand this. Now to go from the N1 condition to the Hochstab condition, which was, so to speak, the core of the Lin's philosophy, then one has a feeling this is halfway, maybe it's not halfway, maybe the only way to understand it is via the Bloch-Bateson conjecture. But for surfaces, we know that. So comment, if X is a surface, then we have at disposal H1, so H0, we don't talk on H0, so we have at disposal H1 and H2, okay? H3 is always supported in codimension 1 via, for example, Artin theorem, or the Wick-Lefschetz theorem we discussed before. Because H3, because 3 is larger than 2, it will die on an affine. So that's this one. So we are just concerned with those two. Now, N1 here, as we know, I mean, it's a topological argument. H1 always injects into H1 of the function field. It's just like saying that topologically, the fundamental group of the Zariski open absorbs subjectively the fundamental group of the variety. So consequently, the condition N1 H1 equals H1 is just equivalent to saying in a simpler way that H1 dies. And N1 H2, what is that? This is just saying we are in H2, so this is just saying that H2 is a Néron-Severi group. So this is equivalent to saying that H2 is generated by chain classes of invertible shapes, so it's a Néron-Severi group. And this, by the comparison theorem, we're talking here on L-adic homology, but by the comparison theorem between L-adic homology and Durand homology, this is equivalent to the same condition on. So this is equivalent, so this is here etal. But then, by the comparison theorem, this is just saying that H2 is a Néron-Severi in the RAM, which in turn, as we know by the Hodge conjecture in codimension 1, is equivalent to saying that H2O is vanishing. Equivalent to saying that H2XO is vanishing, and consequently is equivalent to saying that the Hochstab of H2 is at least 1. And the Hochstab of H1 is certainly at least 1 because it dies. As a consequence, so once we have observed this, then the second corollary of our theorem here is saying that if we have a surface, then we can really go back to the Lin's phrasing. So theorem, so corollary 2, so this was corollary 1. Corollary 2, so if we have a surface, so same KRK as before, but now, so and X is a surface, then assume 1 and 2 replaced by 2 double prime, that the Hodge type of HMX is at least 1 for all M at least 1, then same conclusion. And you see, this, you have nice examples of such surfaces, for example, Mumford-Feck P2, excuse me. And indeed, Mumford-Fex P2 is the Hodge numbers are the same as the ones on the projective space, and actually even more, because K-square also fulfills this. And yet, it is a surface of general types. So that means if I take another prime, so it's constructed over Q2, but if I take another prime, any prime for which I have a regular model, then the reduction mod P of this regular model, we have a rational point. So it's a nice formulation. And here, actually, I could write here, let us come back to corollary one here, and let us be here more, we don't need this very, very large field here. The moment capital K is really a periodic field, we could reduce a little bit. We could replace by omega, where omega contains, this is not what I wanted to say. Omega is a so-called universal domain. This is because capital K is uncountable, but forget those details. It doesn't bring us anything here in the discussion. Okay, so this is a theorem, and certainly I cannot prove it. Forces me to introduce another concept, which is actually a very key point in Delin's proof of the Weyl conjecture, which is in Weyl 2, which is how to understand. You see, so you should think of, maybe I make a diagram here. So we have our model here, which is over spec R. And here we have our general fiber, which is over spec K. And then all we are interested in is to transpose the information we have on the general fiber to an information on the special fiber. That's the game here. That's the target. And if you forget the situation here, you see, one thing I should have said is that one way to think of capital K when one comes from geometry, like I am coming from geometry, so first is arithmetic is a little bit maybe scary, but it's not. I mean, how many, so to speak, directions does one have in capital K? I mean, you see, this R here is a Dedekind ring. So one thinks of a Dedekind ring as a curve, right? So one thinks of capital K as a puncturing curve. So it's a punctured disk, so to speak. I should say it's a disk and it's a punctured disk. But the field of definition of the closed point in my punctured disk, I mean, the puncture itself, is not on an algebraically closed field. It's a field, it's a finite field, which itself, what is Galois theory telling me for a finite field? The Galois group is generated by Frobenius, acting on Artin-Schreier coverings. Yeah? So that means one very geometric way to think of an approximation of this field here is to first think of a power series field in one variable, which would play the role of FQ, and then again to add a new variable which would play the role of the disk. So you have, so to speak, two actions. And if you had here an algebraically closed field, then you would have the general fiber here and the closed fiber which would be over an algebraically closed field. And then, in geometry, there is a way to relate this cohomology of the general fiber to the cohomology of the special fiber. This is the theory of vanishing cycles. So the line in Weyl 2 extends the theory of vanishing cycles to this situation where, first of all, the little field here is not algebraically closed. So this makes the theory more difficult. But one essential feature we have in geometry, which is telling us that if we have a proper, let me write this because it's a key point to start. So one of the general fixtures we have in geometry, so that would correspond, so to speak, to our model, is that the moment we have a proper map, here, so let's just write projective, and delta is an analytical disk, so here I forgot, so to speak, I make this field an algebraically closed field. So I just have this. And what is the, and why here is a special fiber? So that means topologically, this curly X is a tubular neighborhood. And because the morphism is proper, then the cohomology of the tubular neighborhood retracts to the cohomology of Y. And it does the same thing here, but it does, of course, if we don't take into account the Galois cohomology coming from the ground field, so if we go to the algebraic closure of the finite field. So let us write this, and this is the start, which is due to the line, which is telling us that if I consider, if I consider the cohomology of Y bar, bar pulled back to the algebraic closure of the finite field, it is the same by retraction as the cohomology of curly X bar. And curly X bar means over R bar, which is a ring of integers in capital K bar. So, so this is a normalization. And the moment we have a retraction, is that okay? This is just like in topology. Then we can restrict to the generic fiber. So we can restrict here. And the map from the cohomology of the special fiber pulled back to the algebraic closure of the field to the cohomology of the general fiber is called the specialization map. So this stands for specialization. On the other hand, the way to obtain, and then I stop for this before I make a last statement. On the other hand, the way you see this field here, and you see here, if you think of a sort of approximation of this field like this, this field, if you look at its Galois group, then you will have two parts. And this is sort of being the fiber over the field, and this is sort of being the base. So the base corresponds to the finite field, so the Galois group will contain the fundamental group of the fiber and will map to the fundamental group of the base. The fundamental group of the fiber is called the inertia. And what does it do? That those, it parametrizes those coverings of the periodic field which ramifies in the prime of R. And then the quotient is the Galois group of the finite field. Okay? So this means we have a tower of fields here. We have our K. We have our K bar. But inside the field, we have the inertia invariant of K bar. And this is called the maximally non-ramified extension of K. And the Galois group so this is the inertia invariant. So this means the Galois group here is the same as the Galois group of the finite field. So that means it parametrizes the coverings of R, which do not, or of K, which do not ramify at the prime. So, but because the residue field is the same, it's an algebraic closure of the finite field, this contracts this retraction argument, which we have in topology, also works. So that means here there is a new feature, is that this specialization map here factorizes through HMXU, where XU is a pullback. So we have RU, which is a ring of integer in the maximally non-ramified extension of K. So the proof relies on two things. One wants to show that the eigenvalues of Frobenius here are Q divisible as algebraic integers for the Frobenius here. And then one splits this question into the kernel of the specialization map and the image of the specialization map. I forgot to say that this whole diagram is Galois invariant. And for the kernel of the specialization map, this is where we use the regularity of our model by an extension of the classical purity statement, which is due to Hofer-Gabor and which works in unequal characteristic. And for the image of the specialization map, we have to use our assumption on the coniveau filtration. And the way we use this is by using the geometry of de Jong. So it's a bit involved. And in particular, it shows that this group here, so there is a notion, so we did right now is to look at the eigenvalues of the geometric Frobenius acting on varieties defined over finite field. This variety is defined over periodic field. So one has to define the notion of the action of Frobenius on this. So Frobenius is living in the quotient of the Galois group. So it doesn't make any sense. So one has to leave this Frobenius here inside of this large Galois group. And then, of course, it's not unique. But then by a fundamental theorem of Grothendieck, which is telling us that this piece here acts quasi unipotently on the special fiber because our residue field is finite, then it will imply that the eigenvalues of any lifting are the same modulo multiplication by roots of unity. Consequently, if we are interested in Q divisibility of algebraic integers, we are okay, because roots of unity won't perturb our thought. De Ligne is using this for looking at the eigenvalues in complex embeddings. If you multiply by root of unity, it won't change. And here we are looking at integrality of eigenvalues of Frobenius. So this is the thought, and certainly now this would mean basically another false session, which we do not do. But a very important ingredient is a substitute for resolution of singularity in characteristic P, which is due to Johann de Jong, and which already appeared in Takeshi's lecture. So the last statement I wanted to put on the board is a proposition as a conclusion, which is joined with Eckhart, and which says more or less the following. Oh. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the inspiring talks.